हेलो हैकर्स, वेलकम बैक। दिस इज रोग SMG एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टेक द फर्स्ट स्टेप टुवर्ड्स फेलिंग एट बग बाउंटीज। सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल थैंक यू सो मच गाइस फॉर ऑल द लव एंड सपोर्ट यू शोड ऑन द फर्स्ट वीडियो। I hope you guys liked it and I hope you took something from it, and I'll try to keep posting such videos which helps people like you and people like me who are out there. So today we are going to take the first step towards failing at bug bounties. And what exactly is the first steps, you might ask? So the first step towards anything in bug bounties is recon, right? So today we are going to see how I recon. Today I'll show you how I myself do my recon and how maybe you should at least take some tips from it. And if you already not heading in that direction, you should at least take some points and try to cover your recon in the same direction. So let's see. And for the sake of this video, we are going to take Dell as a reference throughout the video. So keep that in mind. So for me particularly, I like to hack on wide scope programs. And as a beginner, I think you should do the same as well. Because what happens is, if you try to hack on a single targeted domain, then it might be that it is already tested by a lot of hackers, and it might be quite hardened for you to test as a beginner. So or try to pick any program which has a lot of subdomains in scope. And what that helps in is, like, let's consider Dell. There are lots of subdomains, and even if there are a lot of people already hacking on that program, it's almost impossible for anyone to maybe check each and every subdomain or test each and every application hosted on that subdomain for each and every vulnerability. So the chances of you finding something as a beginner or as your first bug increases at a very high rate rather than hunting on a single scope domain. So yeah, let's check out what Dell has to say. Dell hosts its program via Bugcrowd. And so as we can see, there are lots of domains in scope, and also it contains some Android and iOS apps if you want to test on that as well. The first step is finding all the subdomains, right? First step is always finding all the subdomains. You want to gather as much subdomains as possible via all the tools or any other brute forcing techniques or whatever it is. We want to gather as many subdomains as we can of the particular target as the first thing. Secondly, what you want to do or what you should do is try to resolve the subdomains. What resolving exactly means is, let's say you found 30k subs from various tools. Let's say you found 30k tool subs from various tools, and the tools might include find domain, subfinder, AMAs. There are lots and lots of tools out there. Recently, Project Discovery released a tool called Chaos, which probably changes the whole recon game a lot much, and it becomes quite easy. You can just query the Chaos API and it will give you all the subdomains which are possibly out there, which all the tools combined might give you. So definitely check that out. I'll post the link in the description below for you. Okay, so back to the topic. So let's say there are 30,000 subdomains you found, but what happens is, many of the tools, what they do, they try to gather the information passively. And what passively means, they try to gather the subdomains from already publicly available places. Everything gets locked on the internet, and if a subdomain ever appeared on the internet somewhere, it most probably got crawled by a search engine or got logged somewhere. So that is what we call passive gathering of subdomains. So it's purely passive. We are not touching the subdomain at all. We are just leveraging what is already available and we are trying to gather the subdomain. But what might happen is at some point of time, the subdomain might be active, but right now they might have taken it down. It might be just hosted for testing purposes or something. So we are not particularly sure that each and every subdomain we found is live or not. So resolving basically means we need to check if the subdomain is currently live or not. This, the second step goes as
resolving subdomain. Is the IP or domain live?
So this is the second step. From now, after resolving, let's say you found
500 live domains, 500 live subdomains.
Okay, just as an example. So you just found 500 live subdomains after resolving, and live in the sense that 500 subdomains are currently active right now and they are running some service which is running on that IP or domain. Okay, now as a next step, what we can do is find the web domains or any domains hosting a web service. Why we are looking for that? We found 500 live subdomains. That doesn't mean all the subdomains have hosted a web service or are running a web application or a website. Many of the subdomains can be running something like a mail service, something like a relay or a DNS service. Anything can be running on that subdomain. It's not necessary that they are running a web server. The resolving or probing just tells us that the IP is live, but not exactly what is running behind that IP. So you can say that we are just checking that if port 80 or 443 is active or running on that subdomain. And for that, we can use something like HTTP probe. This is a tool by TomNomNom, and that is a great guy. He has released so many tools for the community, and you should definitely check his GitHub repo and give him a follow on Twitter. I'll post the link in the description below. So what HTTP probe basically does is it probes the subdomain and checks if port 80 or 443 is open and gives us the result back. There's also another tool which is recently released, which leverages HTTP probe and also gives some other functions like it returns the title of the web page. Basically, so many other options are there. Give it a check out. It is also by Project Discovery, and I'll post the link in the description below. So now, after running HTTP probe and HTTPX, or whatever you might pronounce it, let us say
that you found 200 web domains.
So you found 200 domains which are hosting a web application, or something is running on the port 80 or 443. So most probably there is a possibility that they might be running something else, but most probably it's a web server or a website or web application behind 80 or 443. So now we have 200 of subdomains which are purely hosting something related to web, right? That is good, because from 30,000 we are at 200 domains, and we now confine the place for our initial focus to 200 web domains, right? So that is good. Now the next step should be running port scans on all the live subdomains.
Yeah. Port scans on all subs. And how many live subs we found? 500.
So these were the live subdomains, and we should run port scans on all of them. And why running port scans? Because what happens is, as I already said, 500 are live and 200 are running web services, but 300 of those might be running some other service hosted on some different port, most probably. And it could be something like some internal services or some automation services like Jenkins instances or Jira instances. It can be anything, right? and what is a good possibility that they might be running something which is unauthenticated or which has no login page, is publicly accessible, right? So that should be an easy win for you, or that should be a critical vulnerability if anything you found which is unauthenticated or you could directly access, which should not generally be accessible. Or you could find something which already has a lot of CVEs, right? For example, they might already be running an vulnerable Jira instance which has an unauthenticated RC CVE already available. So that's like a P1 waiting for you, right? The probability is always less for such things, but it's always worth a try. You can never be wrong, right? What's the big deal in trying? So give it a shot. And after running port scans, we should be running directory brute forcing.
So directory brute forcing on all the web domains.
So now let's say there is a subdomain xyz.dell.com. Okay, and it has a login page.
So it's something like xyz.dell.com/auth/login.php.
Right. So what might happen is the main, if you land on this page, then it will take you to a login page, and without login you cannot, it won't let you go ahead. But what happens sometimes is that if maybe login.php is not accessible, but something like test/test.php, this might be accessible. Why? Because the developer might have assumed that no one is going to try anything beyond this, right? Because as such, you cannot get past it without the proper login credentials. So authorization and authentication both are properly implemented here. But what might happen is, beyond that, if you try something and if something or some endpoint is directly accessible because the developer already thought that if the previous thing is not accessible, they won't try this, or they might have not even thought about this possibility, right? So there's always a great chance that you could find something this way, and this is like the most important thing which you could do and which you should always do on any target: direct brute forcing. So how does direct brute forcing go, you might ask? So let's say xyz.dell.com, and you could directory brute force directly after this, or you could also directory brute force after this, or you could also directory brute force after this, right? There is no limitation. And one other very important thing you should do, which helps you get ahead of a lot of hackers which are trying to hack on the same domain or doing the same thing as you, is if you find something after login.php, let's say if you found something here while directory brute forcing, directory brute force after that point as well, right? So what I mean by that is, if you found
/test.
If you found this endpoint test via directory brute forcing, try directory brute forcing after that endpoint as well. There's a lot of chance that you might find something very interesting by this way, and something unique which others might not have found. Because people, what generally they do is they fuzz at the first endpoint or the first URL path and they stop right after that. Not everyone is trying to recursively try to brute force, so there's a very good chance you could find something interesting, and that is not a duplicate, right? So you should definitely try brute forcing. Now there are also many tools for that, but the best and the fastest, which I personally love and I think you should try out, is FOF. This tool is by Johai, another great guy. You should definitely give him a follow and check this out. I'll post the link in the description. FOF is an extremely fast tool. It is so fast that if you provide more than 50 threads and it is a small website which does not have much bandwidth, then it will possibly DOS the server. So be very careful with using this tool. Please keep in mind. So these are basic, most basic steps, and these are the initial path which you should go on if you are not doing anything or if you have no idea where to start. This should provide you a great base to hack on anything, right? And for all this, I myself have made a tool called Scavenger, which does everything which we have just discussed above, and along with that, it does some subdomain brute forcing as well, and some smart brute forcing for the subdomains as well. And at the end, it also gives you Slack notifications at particular intervals of the script. This is no self-promotion or anything like that. This is probably one of the worst tools you might use, right? There are so many frameworks and so many automation tools available out there. But why I use my tool is because I know what's going on in the background, what's actually happening at a certain point of time in the script. That is the only reason I am using the script. And as a beginner, I have not much of experience in Python, and I'm not a coder by any means, but this is just because I wanted to learn a bit of Python and automate the task along the way. So that is why I made Scavenger. And if you are a beginner, you could try to look at the source code and understand what it's doing in the background. I'll certainly make a video on making your own recon tool further in the future. But for now, it's very simple, and you could have a look at its script, right? So the first thing I do is run Scavenger and gather all the data, and I'll show you how the data looks like. So this is my VPS, and we'll talk a little bit about it in just a minute. So what it basically does is it creates a directory. So here it is del.com, and inside that it creates subdomains, directories, web domains as we discussed, and port scans, the result of all the port scans. So let's check out. So these are all the subdomains which were found in Dell. Let's check the count. So there are 13,003 domains which were found, and these were found using multiple tools like Find Domain, AMAS, and I still did not integrate Chaos into it, and I'll definitely change that and integrate Chaos into it in the future. So these are 13,003 live domains, and let's see how many web domains we got. We got 3057 web domains, and let's have a look at that. So these are all the domains where something on HTTP or HTTPS port was found. So there's quite some data, not exactly we can say a lot, but there's quite some data which you have at this particular point of time. And what I generally do is, if I want to hack on a target, I just throw the script, run it, and as it's going on in the background, I do some Google docking or look into Shodan and look at the main domain and stuff like that. And I'll talk more about it in the next video. I just wanted to give a brief and the basic starting point which would help you get rolling into hacking on any target. So this is just for it. And if you want to take a look at the directories, so there are around 4 lakh lines of URLs in the directories. So this is a combined list of all the directories on all the subdomains. So it brute forces it together and it combines it in the same file for easy checking out. This is using FOF, and this is the status code. The first thing is the status code, then the response length, and the URL itself. So you can see there's a lot of thing going on. So at this point you have quite some lot of data, and you are not like thinking about what to do and where to start. You have started and you have something in hand. Now the next step is to look for interesting thing into that subdomains, interesting things into the directory brute forcing, check for port scans. Let's see port scans. So this distributes folder wise, and let's check any folder. Let's say
so there's nothing here. I'll tell you why in a bit. Let's see Dell.com.
So here the IP, here is an IP, open port and services. The port scan uses mascan and mascan to scan the open ports, and the output is passed to nmap to find the services running behind those IPs or domains. So this is how it shows 80443 HTTP as an HTTP. So you could try to, you know, grab services or grab some ports which you might think are interesting, something like 8080 or some 3306 for MySQL, anything like that. All the interesting things you should try from this point, but we'll talk more about it in the next video. And yes, VPS, the script or any automation tool should always be run on a VPS. And why? Because the internet which you and I have at our homes is not stable or not reliable. And if you try to run some resolver, domain resolver like mass DNS or shuffle DNS, it is very likely that it will break your internet connection, because they cannot handle these many packets which the tool is trying to send or they are trying to process. So that is why VPS is recommended, because a VPS directly uses the internet connection at wherever the server is hosted, and that is mostly around something like 1000 Gbps or so, and thus it is extremely reliable and fast as well. And it basically costs you around $4 to $5 per month, but that is an investment you should definitely do, and it will always help you in the long run. So that was something about VPS, and I'll post my DigitalOcean link in the description, and you could get $100 code for 2 months, and you could host your own VPS for free on DigitalOcean for 2 months. So definitely check that out. So that's it for today, guys. On the next time, we'll see what are the interesting things we should look for, what next things we should see, what are the next steps we should perform. This was just to give you a basic idea, just to help you start with something on any target or start with hacking. So thank you so much, guys, for watching. If you enjoyed it or if you learned something, please consider dropping a like and subscribe, and let me know how you found out in the comments down below. Thank you so much, and I'll see you in the next one.